Would you like to know where agentic AI workloads will be hosted in the future? Maybe the data center? Maybe the cloud? Maybe multiple clouds? Maybe everywhere? If so, this video is for you. Hi, my name is Mike Gibbs, and I'm the CEO of Go Cloud Careers, and I've been an enterprise architect now for about 25 years. Today, I'm joined by AI and cloud computing expert, David Linthicum. David is an expert in cloud computing. He's been working in this environment since the beginning. David has been working with AI architecture since the late 1980s, and we're really lucky that he is our AI architect chief instructor, but he's also here sharing his expertise with you today. Hi, David. How are you today?
I'm doing great, Mike. Great to be here.
Thank you for being back. I love when we do these shows together. So, you know, David, agentic AI is, you know, it's taking the world by storm. I mean, it's not a new concept, but we hear about it everywhere. So, you know, when it comes down to it, at the end of the day, where are we going to host these workloads? Do you think it'll be the data center? Because I have a feeling we're going to have a lot of stuff there. You think it'll be the cloud? I think it'll be some of that. Is it going to be everywhere? What do you think, David?
Yeah, it's been coming up a lot lately. And, you know, we just had some, you know, kind of shifting of the cloud market a bit. So people were kind of looking for all AI or majority of the AI to be hosted on the big cloud providers, the hyperscalers, Microsoft, Amazon, and Google. And now, based on some financial results, we saw a few key dynamics. Number one, we saw a huge growth in AI adoption, including agentic AI. And I would say that's bigger than most people think. And we saw people move from a consolidated thing where everything's going to move to a public cloud provider to many different platforms, including colocation providers, which is functionally on-prem, managed service providers, device systems, mobile systems, you know, things like that. And it's everywhere and anywhere, and that's what agentic AI should be. By its definition, we can run it on the platforms where it's going to provide the most value. That's the reason we use it, because we're able to take these applications, divide them up into agents that carry out particular personas and parts of workflows, and they're able to keep intelligence on them and carry out certain goals and objectives, you know, based on some pre-programmed business reason that we have. Okay, well, if it's going to do that, in some cases, it's going to run on laptops, some cases on mobile computing, some cases on devices, some cases on Raspberry Pis, and it's going to run all over the place. So people really kind of have to settle in the fact that if this stuff is going to have value, in other words, we're going to leverage these complex distributed systems, which is really what an agentic AI system is, where these things have their own purpose and personality. They actually function like a human being. They function like an employee. Sometimes they think agents should be called virtual employees because that's what they do. And we're able to host them on any platform where they're going to return the most value back to the business. And so therefore they're going to be anywhere and everywhere. And so as businesses are working through this, it's not necessarily putting everything on AWS, Microsoft, or Google, or even all three. It's put them on 10, 15 different platforms in many instances, because that's the way it's going to provide the best value back for the business. So we have AI agents that are running on trucks now. We have AI agents that are working autonomous cars. We have AI agents that are going to be part of, shipping and logistics systems, and they run particularly on the ships because they're closer to the pallets and the inventory that's there. So everywhere and anywhere. And so it becomes, you know, what's the best platform to run them on? And I think it really is the platform that's going to bring the most value back to the business. We can run them anywhere and everywhere. They have operating systems, they're able to support databases. At the end of the day, AI agents are just a piece of software that run in memory and use processors and use storage systems on any number of platforms. All it needs is an operating system access to those resources, and it's ready to go. It doesn't need huge amounts of processing power. People, you know, try to correct me all the time. Well, I can't put a GPU on my phone. Well, yeah, actually you can, but you don't have to do that because they're very low powered things. And so it becomes kind of quite, you know, a question unto itself, which it has an answer that people don't like, that it depends on what your business needs are. That's how you run the systems. And so you're going to end up with a very complex array of heterogeneous platforms that are supporting these agentic AI systems.
Yeah, and that's the key. Some workloads can run in very different environments. And I think people get so, I have to use this, or I have to use this, that they end up costing 10 times more. I look at cloud computing, for example, and it amazes me that people can't understand why it costs them so much more than the data center, even though it's a landlord-tenant model, where the provider has to build the same thing, and then they have to figure out how to build a sales team, a marketing team, and then customer service, and then support, pay insurance, pay an army of lawyers, and then sell it to you, and still help make a profit. So it has to cost more for some things. But for example, these high volume workloads are much cheaper in the data center, but a sporadic workload and an agile workload might be cheaper in the cloud. And I think the key to maximize, whether it's cloud architecture, enterprise architecture, agentic AI architecture, is realizing that there's a lot of places to put it. In some cases, it's going to be cheapest just to buy a couple of servers and put them in a co-location center. In other cases, it's going to be cheaper to build our data center. In other cases, it's going to be some cloud thing. I hate when I see people just automatically go to one thing without even understanding what they're trying to do, why they're trying to do it, or even understanding the workload. Because to me, that's the architecture failures that we see.
Yeah. And even though complexity has a cost unto itself, if we're able to localize on any number of platforms, we're going to save money on where those platforms run. You just hit the nail on the head. Public cloud computing is typically going to be more expensive than some of the on-prem alternatives. And what happened over the last 10 years is the cost of hardware and software went down significantly. Yes. And also the cost of leasing these systems and putting them in a data center also went down significantly. So it's commoditized, it's automated, you know, all those sorts of things. And so this knee-jerk reaction, we're going to push it into a public cloud provider, even though they have great tools there and they can be the easy button for running some agentic-based systems, is almost never going to be the case. Yeah. It's going to be, we're going to run this on any number of systems that, again, going to bring the value back to the business. And by the way, if someone tells me that, well, these things are going to be centralized anyway, we're going to use agentic AI, but the agents are going to run in a tightly coupled cluster, you know, on a particular cloud provider, I would question the fact that why they're using agentic architectures to begin with. Just use the monolithic system and it's going to be fine and, you know, fine and dandy. I understand you may want to distribute it at some point later, but these agentic systems are going to cost you more to deploy just because they're complex and the architectures are different. Each of them needs data storage and an AI-based system, whether it's an LLM or an SLM, you know, a small language model, things like that. And so we kind of get into these architectural trade-offs. And right now we're at a point, Mike, where, you know, in 2025, people have just started to think about this. So agents are foreign to most people who are getting into architecture now, and they're learning them as quickly as they can. Hopefully they're coming to us to learn about them. And in doing so, we have to build up our own set of best practices and how we do that. And right now I see people, you know, having a huge knowledge gap with what they need to know, the architects and decisions they need to make. And the knee-jerk reaction of just throwing it up on Amazon is not going to pay the bills for you. No. You're going to see hugely inefficient and hugely expensive systems to run. Again, it's going to work. It's going to work for you. Good. But it's going to cost you 10 times as much to running on those platforms. And also you're not getting the value out of the expense and complexity of leveraging agentic AI. We're able to run these agents closer to where they're going to do the most good and the platforms where they do the most good. And you could have 25 agents running on 25 different platforms. That may be the ultimate value you're able to bring back to the business. And that's a good thing. I understand it's scary complexity, but that's what we're doing here. The trade-off is going to be complexity for value. But we're going to have to put some architectural planning. We're going to have to put some observability systems, distributed security management, all those other systems around there to make these things a reality. And you're using heterogeneity to your best end state. You're not trying to throw it up on a homogenous platform. And my fear is that I'm going to walk into a lot of problem domains where they're telling me about their agentic system. Yeah, we did it. Didn't pay. You know, it didn't really, you know, bring the value back we thought it was going to be. And I look at it, everything's running on a single processor, a single platform on a single cloud provider. And so you guys don't really get the idea on why we're doing this stuff and the reason we're making it happen. If there's no viable reason to do it, number one, it shouldn't be used. Use a monolithic system. You know, the same thing with the microservices. It doesn't always make sense to use microservices as containers. Same thing with agentic. But if there's reason to do it, never should it be on a single platform for the entire line of the agents that are running.
Yeah. And let's talk about complexity. So inevitably, when we deal with an enterprise that's got 1,000 different applications, 200,000 IP addresses, 20,000 routes in the routing table, 18 internet service providers, 5,000 remote locations, and a couple of petabytes of data, we are going to have some complexity.
But are you talking about your house, Mike?
Not my house, but most of the clients that I deal with, my house is a bit of a science project too, with an OpenStack cloud running as well as all kinds of TV studios, but that's neither here nor there. But, in the environments we're really talking about, it's really based on the outcome. What are we trying to do? And so many times, every time I get into an architectural situation, I look and I see, and someone picked the tech. They don't know why they picked the tech. It was cool, it was fun, and things just got complex to get complex, like from the monolith to the microservices. If an organization had a lot of developers and they had a lot of reuse and application patterns, it made a lot of sense to have the extra complexity. But a two-person company that has one software developer, it didn't make sense to make things fairly complex. And I think that's where the problem is here. I don't mind adding complexity. If we're going to create 25 types of virtual employees, there's going to be some complexity. Then again, managing 25 different jobs is a whole lot of complexity too. And that complexity is worth it in both cases, but it's not worth it if we're just doing it for tech reasons or picking a better tech or what's more exciting to me or what's going to look good on my resume. All too often, sadly, I see so many of those architectural decisions based on those factors as opposed to what's in the best interest of the business.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that people, like to look this at a binary decision, and it's not like that. So complexity can be an outcome of a good architecture, and it's just something that has to be managed, but it should be considered as something that needs to be observed as you build these architectures. So I run into all the time, people will build these architectures that are way overly complex because they're using different tools and technologies and different security stacks and things like that. And the reason they tell me, the reason it's complex is because it has specific needs that we had to address. And I understand that. But the fact of the matter is that you're using a bespoke solution for every specific need, and getting to a level of complexity where you're not going to have any operational value on top of this is going to be a huge problem. And so therefore, it needs to be considered with the architecture. I get the fact that you're looking to build something using best of breed technology and encourage you to do that. But if you're getting to this complex monstrosity that can't be operated and can't be managed and can't be secured, you're not solving the problem. And so we're dealing with that with agentic. And I think that, it's not a binary decision. It's funny when I advise people on that, they go, well, yeah, I thought you were for agentic AI. You're telling me not to do it. No, I am for agentic AI as an architectural pattern that could be used when it's going to have the most value. The problem you're defining to me now doesn't necessarily need an agentic approach. And you're going to end up paying 3, 5, 10 times more money to get to a system that's going to have much more complexity. And you're going to have to manage that complexity and secure the complexity. So it's going to be extra money to run. So that's what I'm saying. You need to understand the trade-off. So it's not agentic or no agentic. It is agentic and the complexity trade-off going to be correct for the business problems we're looking to solve. And I'm kind of, taken back by sometimes that doesn't come up in more conversations with some of the architects, but you'll remember people came from architecture, say in the last 20 years, everything's going to be bespoke. Everything's going to be related to what seems to be hypey at the time. That's why people are leveraging containers and microservices, object-based development, service-oriented development, things like that. When it comes down to a meta architecture that's going to make most sense for the business, that needs to be considered. And so it's not about what is the coolest technology. It's about the right architectural approach for what you're looking to build to get to the right logical architecture. We map that into a physical architecture with any number of tools to make that happen, but we minimize complexity as much as we can because that's going to reduce the operational expenses and make the things more secure. It's never going to be completely eliminated. And certainly if you're building an agentic system, but there also needs to be a business purpose for building an agentic system, a business purpose to moving to that level of complexity. And those are questions that just come down in planning. And I think they need to be asked. Yeah. I think a lot of the architects out there are oversimplifying the solution that everything needs to be complex.
Yeah. And I think there's a big difference between an architecture that came from an architecture framework that recommends the same thing to every single client, regardless of their needs, And there's a difference between understanding the organization's needs, understanding what that organization does well, its business architecture, its value streams, understanding what that organization's employees do and employees need, understanding what the customers want, and finding some way to figure out how to optimize the process, then figure out how to get the people that work at the company the best technology based on doing their jobs and doing their jobs best, not anything else. Whatever makes that employee better that optimizes that process, to me, that's the solution to architecture, people, processes, and technology.
You got it.
So, you know, David, thank you for talking about agentic AI, where it's going to be hosted. You know, you and I have been watching this stuff unfold for decades now, but, you know, every time it's still fun. It's still like, okay, I bet this is going to happen again versus this is going to happen again. And it's good to see. So thank you for sharing your expertise and wisdom with our audience.
Always happy to do it, Mike.
Thank you so much, David. If you'd like to become an AI architect, cloud architect, enterprise architect, security architect, or network architect, join us on a free webinar. You'll speak to either me or David or both of us. We'll talk about what we do as architects, the skills you need to be hired, and then we'll spend whatever time we can to answer your questions as well, anything we can to assist you in your career. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a like, subscribe to our channel, and hit the bell to be notified of new videos to assist you in your technology career. This is Mike Gibbs and David signing off for now. We'll see you real soon.